So today in this seminar series, Ms. Shobha Rani is going to talk about her PhD work, the research work related to biotreatment of domestic wastewater and how to use efficiently in agriculture. Ms. Shobha is working here since last 3 years. Out of that 1 year, she has did her coursework. And last two years, she is doing research related to treatment of domestic wastewater and as well as the how to use that treated wastewater in agriculture. So it has two parts. One part is related to treatment and another is use in agriculture. Specifically, it is for the non-food crop, that is lemongrass. So I welcome you all and also request Shobha to limit her presentation in 30 minutes and remaining half an hour we can use for the discussion. Shobha.
Good afternoon everyone, I'm Shobha and today I'm going to present my research work, that is biotreatment of domestic wastewater and its efficient use in agriculture. And my topic contains, these are my objectives and the biotreatment of wastewater, that is its characterization and wastewater treatment by constructed wetlands and the efficiency of constructed wetlands in treating wastewater. And coming to wastewater reuse study, it contains two germination experiments and one field scale study. This is my introduction. As we all know, present days the world is facing an acute water scarcity problem. Not only developing countries, including developed countries, are also facing acute water shortage. And the main area which, or the main field which is going to affect due to the water scarcity is agriculture. Because from available freshwater resources, the 70% of water is used by agriculture. That's why the main area which is affected by water scarcity is agriculture. So to cope up with agriculture, we need to find new ways like reuse of wastewater for agriculture and reuse of treated wastewater for gardening, flushing, etc. And coming to the our Indian scenario and wastewater generation, the mega cities, class 1 and class 2 cities like Hyderabad, Mumbai, Kolkata are the main cities which generate highest amount of wastewater, that is up to according to CPCB calculations, 38,000 liters of wastewater is generated every day. Among that water, only 12,000 million liters of water is treated. So there is a gap between wastewater generation and treated wastewater. Coming to Hyderabad also, 1800 liters of wastewater is generated. Among that, only 750 million liters of water was treated. So to fill the gap between wastewater generation and wastewater treatment, there is a necessity to develop treatment methods. One of the treatment methods which we can treat the wastewater is also economic and cheapest way is the wastewater treatment by using constructed wetlands. And objectives of my study are to assess the municipal wastewater, that is domestic wastewater, for its suitability for agriculture reuse and to treat the domestic wastewater by using constructed wetland. And to calculate the coming to third objectives, to calculate the efficiency of domestic treatment capacity of constructed wetlands. And coming to fourth objectives, that is by using wastewater, reusing wastewater, what is the impact of wastewater on soil and plant? And these are the parameters which I have analyzed to fulfill my first objective, that is characterization of wastewater for its suitability for agriculture. And for this purpose, I have analyzed freshwater that is fresh water, that is borewell water, and inlet, that is untreated wastewater, outlet, that is treated wastewater from constructed wetlands. And these are the different parameters which I have analyzed, and all the parameters which are regulated by BA standards are meeting by treated wastewater. Coming to my second objective is to that is treatment of municipal that is domestic wastewater by using constructed wetlands. To perform this activity, submerged type of constructed wetlands are constructed at ICRISAT campus, and the wetland system includes a collection tank that is to collect domestic wastewater receiving from nearest township, and a constructed wetland system and a storage tank to store the treated wastewater. And coming to constructed wetland system, here the it is a picture which we can see the whole system of constructed wetland, and this is the collection tank. This is the collection pond. Actually, from the outside, that is outside township, we are getting the wastewater here. From collection pond, we are pumping the wastewater to collection tank. From that, the whole system is going to receive. And this is the collection tank. Here we can see the collection tank, and this is the wetland system. Here we can see the different chambers of wetland. Each cell is divided into four chambers, that is chamber A and chamber B, chamber C, and the blue color covered one is chamber D. And chamber A and chamber D are without media, that is they are not filled with media, and chamber C and chamber chambers B and chamber C are filled with media, that is sand media, and they are vegetated with the first wetland vegetated with typha latifolia, and the second second cell, that is B, chamber C, is vegetated with agaritan conified species. And coming to second wetland cell, it is also again divided into four chambers, A, B, C, and D. And the B chamber is vegetated with Canna indica, and the C is again with agaritan conizides. And the wastewater is sent into the chamber A, and chamber E is to settle down the suspended matter and to maintain the hydraulic conditions in these two cells. And after treatment, the whole the treated water is collected in a storage tank. From that, it can be applied to the fields. And coming to the wetland treatment mechanisms, means by which mechanism the wetland the constructed wetlands are going to remove the nutrients. They are divided into physical process and biological and biochemical removal processes. That is, coming to physical processes, in cell in chamber A, in both the wetlands, the water is allowed to settle down for some time. So there, by settling down, the all the suspended matters, some extent of suspended matters are settled down and they are removed. And and coming to biological processes, the main plants involved in the removal of nutrients by biological process, that is phytodegradation. Coming to phytodegradation, the direct uptake of plants, the direct uptake of nutrients from the water or from the soil media by plants is known as the phytodegradation. And the rhizodegradation, coming to rhizodegradation, plants, roots secrete some amounts of secretion. They have the capability to degrade the nutrients or pollutants. And phytovolatilization is the through microbial metabolism. Coming to microbial metabolism, the microbes which are accumulated in the soil media, sand media, can uptake nutrients or pollutants which are present in the wastewater, and they can degrade those nutrients by two methods, that is aerobic processes, aerobic and anaerobic process. They use the those nutrients which are present in the water for their metabolic activities. And coming to biochemical process, and this is direct volatilization, is direct evaporation of nutrients are pollutants and photooxidation is due to the sunlight. In our wetland construction, some amount of suspended solids are removed by the U-bent, which we can see in the picture. From collection tank, the system, the whole wetland system is going to receive through these pipes. Due to these bends, some amount of suspended solids are clogged. So due to some, regularly these cloggings are cleared and some extent of suspended solids are removed. In this slide, we can see the removal efficiency of constructed wetland, which is planted with Typha latifolia and Agaritum conizoides. And the results are represented during the period of January 2015 to December 2015. Here you can see the various parameters like TDS, TSS, DOD, COD, and nitrates, ammonia, sulfates. These are the removal, every month removal percentages of the nutrients. And this is a slide showing the removal efficiency of pollutants from the cell planted with Canna indica and Agaritum conizoides, and from the period January 2015 to and December 2015. And as my source of wastewater is domestic, it contains E. coli, that is coliforms. By using wetlands, we can remove some extent of coliforms. By using wetlands, up to 75% of coliforms are removing. In wetlands, the coliforms are removed by following methods. They are by sedimentation and natural die-off and filtration through sand media, and some amount of microorganisms can be die by predation, means by they act as food for another organisms. And nutrient removal by plants. The plants play major role in the nutrient removal of wastewater from by constructed wetlands. Plants uptake the nutrients or the pollutants which are present in the water, and they grow and they utilize those nutrients or the pollutants for their growth. And coming to the species differentiation, here we can see the Canna indica plant is very effective. Canna indica and Agaritum conizoides is very effective in removing phosphates. And coming to Typha and Canna indica, they are efficient in removing sulfur. And this is a slide showing the amount of nutrients which are accumulated in the plant shoot tissues. On every month basis, I will collect the root and shoot tissues of plants from the wetland, and they are analyzed for nutrient. And these are the nutrients, concentrations of different nutrients we can see in the plant tissues of different species. Typha plant, highest amount of zinc is accumulated in Typha, and highest amount of calcium is accumulated in Typha, and chromium, which we can means trace amounts of chromium which we present in Typha, and highest amount of iron can be accumulated in conizoides, and magnesium in Agaritum conizoides plant. And coming to this slide, it shows the nutrients which are present in root tissues of plants. And here again, Typha is showing highest concentrations of calcium in their roots. And coming to Canna indica, it shows the highest concentrations of magnesium, and it shows the highest concentrations of sodium. And coming to conizoides Agaritum, it shows the highest concentrations of sulfur. Not only the nutrient removal mechanism is not only by plant, the sand media which is present in the wetland also retains some amounts of nutrients. Here in control cell, that is without vegetation, the highest amount of nutrients are present in control cell, because here in control cell there is no vegetation, so highest amount of nutrients are present in the are retained in the sand media. And coming to cell 1 and 2, that is planted with typha and agaritum conizoides and Canna indica and agaritum conizoides, they show some less amounts than the control cells. And these are the heavy metals and micronutrients which are retained in the sand media of constructed wetlands, that is control and cell 1 planted with typha and agaritum conizoides, and cell 2 planted with Canna indica and agaritum conizoides. And coming to third objective, that is reuse study. For reuse study, for wastewater reuse, we have conducted three experiments. They are two lab scale experiments and one field scale experiment. And coming to lab scale experiment, I have done two germination experiments to know the impact of wastewater on seed germination. Coming to first experiment, I have conducted first experiment with the following seeds, that is they are maize, chickpea, PGNP, cowpea, whole millet, sorghum and mustard seeds. And large seeds like maize, large seeds like maize, chickpea, PGNP are incubated for 5 days and they are irrigated with 5 ml of treatments. They are untreated wastewater, that is diluted with 50% distilled water and 100% untreated wastewater. And coming to all these 4 types of seeds, in all types of seeds, untreated wastewater, that is diluted with 50% distilled water, shown good germination parameters like germination percentage and seedling length, both radical and plumulates, and seed vigor index. And the highlighted values are the highest values among the 4 types of seeds, and which are treated with untreated water, wastewater, has shown good results. And these are the small seeds which are incubated for 7 days. These are also irrigated with 5 ml of distilled water daily. And coming to these also, the untreated wastewater has shown very good results. This has shown very good germination percentage and seedling length and vigor index. This is a picture showing the germination test. And coming to second germination test, second germination test is performed to know the impact of nutrient uptake by seeds. Means the seeds are treated with wastewater, so there is an impact on nutrient uptake from the wastewater. So to know that the second germination test was performed and the water treatments are used are control, that is distilled water, and fresh water, that is tap water, and inlet, that is untreated wastewater, outlet, that is the outlet water, means treated water from the constructed wetlands. Here the seeds used for the germination test are maize, chickpea, PGNP and cowpea. And from this germination, among these all seeds, the seeds which are treated with outlet, that is treated wastewater, has shown good results, good germination percentage and seedling vigor index. And coming to seedling length, the inlet water, that is untreated wastewater, shown highest seedling length. And this is the nutrient concentrations in the seedlings. The seedlings after germination test, the seedlings were oven dried and are ground to ground, and the powder was used for analysis. And when the analysis was done for all seedlings which are irrigated with untreated wastewater has accumulated highest amount of nutrients in all highest amount of nutrients in all types of seeds, iron, zinc, calcium, magnesium, all are highest highest amount are accumulated in untreated wastewater, the seeds which are irrigated with untreated wastewater. I can conclude that from these two germination tests, the germination percentage and seedling vigor index are highest in the seeds which are irrigated with untreated wastewater 50%, that is, which is diluted with 50% distilled water and treated wastewater. But coming to seedling length, after germination, germination is somewhat obstructing the highest amount of nutrients because due to the loss in osmotic pressure. But after germination, the nutrients which are present in the untreated wastewater, they are uptaken by the seedlings and they show very good seedling lengths. And coming to field study, that is reuse of wastewater for growing crops. I have selected a crop that is a non-food crop, that is lemongrass, Simpopogon, and it is a perennial crop, and the two plots are prepared near the constructed constructed wetland site, and the treated plot is irrigated with treated wastewater which is collected in the storage tank. From the storage tank, the water is pumped into the field. And coming to the when the water is applied to the field, it shows impact on soil and also the plant. And coming to the impact on soil, that is biological parameters, when the wastewater, this is a picture showing the lemongrass field, and when the wastewater is applied to the field, the number of bacteria are increased. But I have started my experiment, that is March 2015, up to April and May, the number of microorganisms are increased. And after May, June, July, due to monsoons, due to heavy rains, again the water, the wastewater irrigation is stopped due to rains. Again, the bacteria are decreased. The same trend we can see in the deep soils also. I have collected both surface soils and deep soils. The same trend it is following in deep soils also. And coming to effect of wastewater on soil parameters, same as I told before, my experiment was started in March, and due to heavy rains in June and July, the wastewater irrigation was stopped. Due to that, the EC and organic matter in the soil was decreased, and again due to plant utilization, it is again decreased up to post harvesting stage, and we can see the same trend following in deep soils also. And here in nutrient analysis, that is the individual factors which is affecting the soil parameters are the NPK, the major nutrients for plant growth. And when the wastewater, before transplantation, these are the concentrations of NPK, and these are the concentrations of NPK during vegetative stage of microbe, and after harvesting, these are the concentrations of NPK, and highest concentrations, the concentrations of nitrogen before transplantation is, and this is the value, and after applying wastewater, it is increased to 1041 mg per kg. And the same trend, the here it is 817, and after applying the wastewater, it increased to this. From this, I can conclude that the NPK concentrations in the wastewater irrigated field are increased. And coming to the micronutrients and heavy metals. As my source water, that is domestic wastewater, containing trace amounts of arsenic, and after application, the amount of arsenic in soil is also increased. In surface soils also it is increased, and in deep soils also it is increased. And coming to cadmium, cobalt, there is no amount traces of cadmium and cobalt in wastewater and water source, so they have not affected the soil parameters. And coming to chromium, only some traces of chromium are present. And coming to lead, no traces of lead are present in wastewater, so it has not affected the water soil parameter. And the same trend is following in the deep soils. And here we can see the nutrients like calcium, magnesium and sodium. As the wastewater source is containing high amounts of calcium, magnesium and sodium, they are affecting, ultimately they are affecting the soil parameters also. Here we can see the increasing trend of calcium, magnesium, sodium after at harvesting stage. When the wastewater is applying, the amount of these elements in the soil are increasing. And coming to overall biomass calculation, after three harvestings, the average biomass which was yielded by the treated wastewater field is 5794 kg per acre, and control field is 5395 kg per acre. And as I told, the lemongrass is a commercial crop. We can extract oil from it. That oil can be used in preparing perfumes, soaps and medicines, etc. I have extracted the oil from lemongrass by using salicylate method. Two types of leaves I have taken for oil extraction, that is fresh leaves and dry leaves. And the oil content is more in dry leaves. Control yielded 14.5% of oil from fresh leaves, and the field which is irrigated with the treated wastewater yielded 17.2%. And treated wastewater fresh leaves yielded 14.7, and with the dry leaves it is 17.5. Here we can observe the treated wastewater yielded more oil percent than the control. And from the from my study, I can conclude that with the germination experiments, the untreated wastewater diluted with 50% distilled water and the treated wastewater are showing the good results on seed germination, that is seed germination percentage, seedling length and vigor indexes. And coming to that is wetland field scale study, the overall efficiencies of wetland are we can see here the TSS, that is suspended solutes, are effectively removed by wetlands, and coliforms are also very effectively removed by coliform wetlands, and remaining nutrients like ammonia, nitrates, sulfates, phosphates are also effectively removed by constructed wetlands. After treating the wastewater, when we applied for field, the field also showed good results than the control. When we compared to control, the yield was more in lemongrass field which is irrigated with treated wastewater. And these are my publications. Thank you for all.
So now topic is open for any queries or any comments.
Very interesting result, Shobha. But was there a mass balance? Did you plan for mass balancing the whole result?
No.
Okay. But would that be possible because of the variation? Huge,
yeah.
Variation. What?
Let me just moderate your question. You are asking about the constructed wetland or the germination test?
Constructed wetland results. I'm asking, would it be possible to do a mass balance of the results? especially the results of the metals and the other salts
in plants of
how much was in the collection tank and how much was in the inlet, how much was in the plant, how much was in the soil.
If we try to do some
It is possible. You would clearly know where it has been really absorbed. What has been mineralized and how much really went into the pond. That would be really interesting.
Yes, it is possible. But I have not done that. It is possible.
Yeah, you could still try to do that.
Hi, Shobha. Congratulations.
Thank you.
And I have a couple of suggestions for you as well as questions. First one, if this is really your thesis presentation, you should have touched a couple of slides on materials and methods.
Yeah.
And literature review as well.
Okay.
So you need to first discuss what research was done before and how your results were compared to that.
Thank you.
Yeah, materials and methods and literature is the heart of any thesis.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering, why were you not advised to do any stat analysis?
Yeah, I will do, ma'am. I'm interpreting my results using ANOVA.
I haven't seen any replications in your germination test.
Actually, I have done with three replicates, but here I have presented average value from replicates.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the reason why I was insisting on materials and methods.
Yeah.
Because you need to let the audience know what exactly you have found.
Okay. Thank you.
And your ANOVA results are very valuable because stating your results in high and low note is it doesn't play any role in research.
Okay.
I'm curious about any of the health issues. So you touched on total coliforms a little bit, but I'm just wondering, that would be a concern of using wastewater on plants, and I don't know if you have any information or could talk a little bit more about that.
Yeah, actually, as the source of wastewater is domestic, it contains high amounts of coliforms. But after treating with wetlands, up to 75% of coliforms are removing. And so that's why I'm applying that water to a field. That is, I'm selected a crop like with lemongrass, which is one food crop.
Is 75% removal enough? Removal? Does it decrease the chance of disease transmission? Because there's some...
Still, there is a chance of disease transmission, and that's why this is a commercial crop. So directly, when the it will not reach to the consumers for direct. So the oil which we extract from the leaves only will reach to the consumers. So there is no effect of.
So, do you recommend this for other crops for direct consumption?
People are using, like we can take a Musi River example, people are using, but it is showing adverse effect on people, not only coliforms, other pathogens, heavy metals.
Any other questions? Okay, Shobha, I have one question. So now you are completing your thesis by next year or end of this year.
Yes, sir.
So maybe we have good suggestions also you need to incorporate in your while you are writing thesis.
Yes.
And all those things you have to incorporate.
Yes,
and another thing, one point need to be considered, that how you going to, what is the major conclusion out of your studies? Is it usable in the field? How means you are going to send them one message from your, you have done treatment and use in agriculture.
Yeah.
So what message you want to disseminate to larger audience? Mm-hmm. In simple way.
Means instead of using untreated wastewater, we can treat domestic wastewater, not only domestic wastewater, wastewater by using not only constructed constructed wetland is a economical method. So like these methods, we can apply that water for irrigation. And why I have taken the crop is this is the crop which we can grow by less inputs. And this is the study. My study may helpful for poor farmers like that.
Can you use this technology to treat the city wastewater?
Yeah, city wastewater is much polluted than this which I have. Mainly heavy metals.